Any disturbing emotion that may arise is wisdom the moment you relax to your natural mind. Look directly into it. Don't deliberately reject it, regard it as a fault, indulge in it concretely, or regard it as a virtue. The more I live my life tuning to Dharma, attempt to live life dharmically, live my life and see it becoming more dharmic, certain words come through really strongly, like the word balance and the word patience. I see myself going through life in which phenomena appear, and some of them captivate me immensely, and my awareness goes into a thought relationship to that particular phenomenon. And at that moment, I lose some balance. I lose the spacious ground in which that phenomenon exists. And then sometimes I keep letting go of thoughts, letting go of thoughts, letting go of thoughts, until there is just awareness. Resting in that.
Presence there is offered. Is one, the empathy. We're all in this together. And the other is, but we don't need to be caught. This is two bits of information. I realize now more and more that what we offer each other as human beings, we offer each other an environment. And that exercise is keeping me in the environment of that balance, so that I'm in an environment where if that other person wants to come out and play from the pain and the suffering, here I am. And if they're in the pain and suffering, here I am. But there's nothing in me that's keeping them stuck in the pain and suffering. And there's nothing in me demanding. That's the interesting one. It's the interesting one about reality regarding other human beings' consciousness. Tim and I wrote an article back in 1963 from the Harvard Review called Politics and Consciousness, in which we are arguing that each individual consciousness is the true one. fulfilling your needs makes you happy, and whether fulfilling your needs makes you any happier than not fulfilling your needs. It's an interesting one. It does for the moment, there's no doubt about it. But if you notice that when you live on the realm of needs, the minute one is done, another one appears. You have a hierarchy of needs. So like a motivational hierarchy. I need food. Now I need ice cream. Now I need television. Now I need a cold drink. Now I need some popcorn. Now I need to go to bed. If you notice that, you just go from one need to another, and each one is, and then, and then, and then, it's extraordinary. It's extraordinary. Now these are all going on all the time. We all have needs and desires. We all have all this stuff. But just like I'm not going around being a bald man, I am bald, relatively speaking. To those of you that don't have eyes to see. But my consciousness is not full of baldness. It's an also-ran. Sure. In my hierarchy of desires, if I have the power, yogic powers that Patanjali talks about, I'll create a beautiful head of hair for myself. As a whim, just to I did it on the astral plane, so those of you that can see know. Goes out and it catches you, and you immediately go into the I'll make believe you are who you think you are, if you'll make believe I am who I think I am. So you don't even look to see who it is. You don't see God as your only friend. You don't see that could be God in drag. You see who they think they are, and you respond to it. And so everybody is. invite you to examine the way in which your identity with your roles and your personality dynamics are creating a very rigid system with other people. And whether or not you are using the relationships in a way to get free from that, first of all, do you realize you're interacting? And I wrote a chapter in How Can I Help called Helpless Prison. The way in which you get into helping because it makes you feel righteous, it relieves suffering, it's all good things. So you get into, I'm a helper. And I realized as I examined the dynamics of my own helping and the helping of the people around me, how disempowering this was to everybody else around me. How it needed helpless people to help. And I was seeing how you could give something to somebody.
What you want. They brought him paper and a pen and he wrote, "Dear Hilda, I didn't find what I wanted here. I'll be back on Tuesday. Did you water the plants?"
And he didn't think, I think I'll show Ram Dass a lesson. His behavior, because each person in the room always thought the action was directed at them. Okay? Everybody in the room, that was the far out part. And I'm sure he didn't sit and say, well, now for him I'll do this, and then for him I'll do this, but if I move my hand this way, he'll get it. And he just did it.